Okay.
I think we'll start. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you here tonight, students, faculty, and guests, to this year's MFA thesis reading. I'm going to offer a very brief introduction. And this past year, I taught the thesis component of the MFA curriculum, along with my colleague, Francis Richard, who will then offer some concluding remarks at the end of tonight's reading, and then moderate a brief Q&A with our writers. I've taught at CCA for quite a long time, but I feel that this year's graduating cohort is a particularly special and resilient one. During the program, they have experienced a number of unexpected transitions, only then to have our current global pandemic upend the traditional public events and showcases we have all come to expect and look forward to at the end of the academic year. They have overcome these challenges one after the other with fortitude, creativity, and solidarity. I really admire them for this. They've shown a resiliency that bodes well for them as they navigate their respective futures in what will inevitably be a new reality and a different kind of art world for all of us. So tonight, we have the distinct pleasure of hearing from 9 students from this year's cohort. Each will read an excerpt from their thesis project, which they've worked on pretty intensively for the better part of this year. The written thesis, I feel, is actually one of the unique aspects of the MFA program at CCA. It brings together the myriad facets of each artist's practice, critical inquiry, personal exploration, and commitment. It's a chance to dig deep into the nature of their creative work and produce a substantial and sustained piece of writing, whose backbone is research and an inquisitive methodology. As a professor, what I hope students will discover along the way is just how exciting and productive it is to have a constant dialogue and cycle of exchange between reading, writing, looking, and making in developing one's own critical voice. It's truly special when a student writes to me years later just to let me know that ideas and avenues of exploration that began to percolate in their thesis work are still evolving and functioning as engines for their continuing visual practice. The MFA thesis projects tonight reflect the diversity of artistic visions that exist in this cohort. Their work questions the limits of the human and the post-human, the impact of technology, social constructions of gender, the tyranny of authoritarian and fundamentalist regimes, and also share profound concerns about precarity, what it means to be human as we witness increasing social inequity, climate crisis, and continued attacks on civil rights. So our first speaker tonight is Gillian Crochet, who is also the winner of the MFA Thesis Prize this year. And she was selected by this year's judge, Claudia LaRocco. And Claudia, as many of you know, is a widely published writer and poet and frequent interdisciplinary collaborator with composers, choreographers, and artists. Her work has been presented at such venues as the Walker Art Center, the Whitney Museum, the Kitchen, and many other places. So I want to thank Claudia on behalf of the MFA program for her time and consideration. And of course, we also want to take this moment to celebrate Gillian. So congratulations, Gillian, on winning this year's thesis prize. And as I said, Gillian's going to be our first reader tonight. And her thesis, as Gillian describes herself, is a mix of histories of touch and breath, a soft, unscientific science that examines how performance work, video, and sculpture allows her to reclaim her time and power, as well as liberate the disabled body from marginalization and oppression. So now it's my pleasure to pass the virtual mic to Gillian, who will start off our evening together. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Hi, I'm Gillian Crochet. Through my sculpture, performance, and video, I'm investigating touch as an alternative form of communication through reciprocal modes of embodied interaction, might we expand understanding beyond the visual through touch and haptics? If I can engage unconscious and bodily reactions to my work, can I bypass learned behaviors and elicit empathy for the other, the disabled body? If plants are sentient and can communicate with humans, as evidenced in the book, The Secret Life of Plants, is it possible to learn from algae, my primordial ancestor? I use soft science, my own futile and chaotic practice of trial and error, to attempt to preserve algae and keep it alive. Examining my compulsive motivations towards preservation and control, desires born out of grief. My work seeks to communicate through primordial awareness, the innate and nebulous that is so familiar that is unknown, embodied knowing that shapeshifts and exists as many things at once. Use the word primordial to describe a way of knowing formed at the beginning of time, and therefore the beginning of the body. Something so instinctive within ourselves that we struggle to find the words to describe it, to understand it, for it came before words. How many bacteria mutated genetic structures until the mutation of my own? If algae is my primordial ancestor, perhaps algae from the bayou, where my mother grew up and her father and his mother have shared genetic history, epigenetic memory. Made out of the desire to find answers to the unknowable, my objects become portals for time travel, communication devices. Maybe the gentle agitation of algae within an IV bag will caress extrasensory understanding into consciousness. Maybe I can speak to the primordial goop. Maybe it can soothe my pain and disentangle inherited mysteries buried in the swamp. Maybe it can help me find ease in the discomfort. I am obsessed with the breath, the quintessential act of repetition, the input and output. A dying body is hooked up to a breathing apparatus. Is consciousness gone once the body can no longer breathe on its own? Is a body alive if it is part machine, robot, mechanization, industrialization? My body forgets to take a breath. Glitches happen in time. Glitches in memory. I yawn. I need to sleep with a sleep apnea mask, but I can't sleep, even before I strap tubes to my nose. I'll never sleep, hooked to electricity. If my body forgets, my brain forgets. The machine will carry on without me, forcing air inside. My body stops breathing. I wake up in a sweat, shivering uncontrollably. Preservation of life repeated over and over each night. I've been trying to make my objects breathe. Or is it let my objects breathe? Bubbles rise quickly from below, a gentle soothing sound, continuous, dependable, oscillating. Deep green algae floats and flutters in a yellow liquid. The color of a page from an antique book. Transparent plastic, slightly opaque, hangs from an industrial steel rolling IV stand. Hanging from the IV bag, the medical tube should be pumping life-saving liquids, but the process is reversed. Instead of liquid, it is air. Instead of giving, it is receiving. Reversed. An escape valve of copper allows built-up pressure to release. The bag is a third full and heavy, weighted. How long will this intervention hold? How long can this algae stay alive by artificial means? I see it is dying already, but maybe I put dead algae in there by mistake. Maybe it hates constant agitation. I think about the dawn of time and how far back it was that algae made the atmosphere inhabitable. Evolution, combining more and more life forms until it made me, between 900 to 1900 million years ago. In a chance event, an ancient complex cell swallowed a cyanobacteria and gained its ability to photosynthesize. That one fused cell then gave rise to all algae and plants, which made life on Earth possible, changing the atmosphere to oxygen. Blobs of algae are formless and undefined, much like my lumpy surrogates. They resist on the horizontal dimension and find ways to escape enclosure. They never take the same shape twice. In fact, it seems impossible to shape the lumpies. They merely fall, recline, plop, sag. They ooze and undulate until they settle. Gravity, their one true mistress. I think about the physicality of gravity, its demanding and opposing force. My muscles defy resistance. My body sways to find balance, vastly over-adjusting, forever searching for center. Memory of floating in warm liquid in the womb, cicadas gently announcing dusk, the menacing and deafening roar of prehistoric-sized crickets on a sweltering summer night, the idealized memory of a place, mysterious and oddly comforting, thick fog, dangerous and haunting, curling around trees, hovering just above the swamp, obscuring the road, dislocating time, the scent of moist earth, dark and fertile, decaying rot of limbs fallen with the weight of damp, sagging moss that hangs like wet, draped lace. Grass so moist it soaks your socks as you wade through thick tufts that grow faster than the weekly trim can manage. The squish of mud as your shoes sink below the wet earth. The squelch as you struggle to pull each foot free, slowing your movements. Swinging your arms wide to catch your balance and pull yourself through humidity so thick you can feel the air floating around your body. Thank you. Now it is my pleasure to introduce the next artist, Courtney O'Dell.
Thank you, Jillian, and congratulations. My name is Courtney O'Dell, and this is my thesis called In the Beginning. How strange is it that I could have ceased to exist, yet here I am? How strange is it that I was born into a world that can sustain my life? That the air is the perfect amount of oxygen for me to breathe? That the sun is the perfect distance away to foster my life and other lives? That there is water for me to drink and food for me to eat? That I was born of the matter of this earth? How strange is it that I was born a human? That I am aware of my own existence, my consciousness, and my own impermanence. That I am following a 6 million year long history of humans who came before me. That I belong to an incredibly evolved species that has developed sciences to reveal various truths about our reality. How strange is it that I will someday die, that my body will decompose back to the earth, that I don't know what to expect from the experience, that I will no longer cease to exist, but only in memory. A quote from David Batchelor. Color threatens or promises to undo all of the hard-won achievements of culture. It threatens or promises chaos and irregularity. Color threatens disorder, but also promises liberty. Color is my expression of all of the beauty and terror of the human condition. In certain Western cultural traditions, color has often been associated with Christianity's idea of the fall of humanity, our expulsion from perfection and acquisition of knowledge and confusion. While a black and white world represents order and harmony, color represents passion, temptation, and deceit. The duality that is often attributed to color from this cultural vantage point maintains that color is either beautiful and seductive or something that can be destructive and chaotic. Yet color is just as natural a part of this world as we are. In looking at nature, vivid colors are a symbol of vitality. A plant that has reached full bloom tends to be at its most colorful. Yet color can either indicate a plant that is rich and nutritious or one that is highly poisonous. When I work with color, I think of it as embodying the dilemma of our instinctive and innermost cravings as human beings. In my work, color is a flamboyant celebration of this gift of existing as a conscious being. This includes longings to learn, to procreate, and to feel the rapture of being alive. Understanding my own existence propels my work because I'm under the impression that if I should be able to understand my existence, I will know what to do with it while I have it. Humans are highly conscious beings, and our self-awareness allows us to wonder about existence itself, to be critical of it, and attempt to understand it. However, our own nature is such that we have inevitably become an invasive species to the natural world. And now we have clear evidence that climate change is happening. How do we both celebrate the gift of consciousness and uphold the responsibility that comes with it? These kinds of dualities are present within ourselves and all of creation. Anything that exists must have an equal opposite. My birth versus my death, my body versus my spirit, good versus evil, physical versus spiritual, concrete versus abstract, beauty versus terror, beautiful versus grotesque. I am intrigued by the idea that opposites exist on the same continuum and therefore are one and the same. While there are two sides of a coin, there is still only one coin. Within my work, dualities are prevalent and juxtaposed against one another to create a formal tension. Hard versus soft, bright versus dull, new versus old, solid versus translucent, smooth versus hard, matte versus glossy, wet versus dry, taut versus slack, positive versus negative, architectural versus organic, natural versus synthetic, and visible versus invisible. A quote from Joseph Campbell. But if you think of ourselves as coming out of the earth, rather than having been thrown in here from somewhere else, you see that we are the earth, we are the consciousness of the earth. These are the eyes of the earth, and this is the voice of the earth. The relationship between my different art pieces reflects my attitudes towards the kinship shared between living things in the sense that we all originate from the same source and share much of the same genetic makeup. Everything we see is comprised of matter that was present during the universe's creation, and everything on the earth is made of the earth. We share 96% of our genetics with a chimpanzee, and 60% of our genetics with a banana, with a wide spectrum of other matter in between. Casting is a process I frequently use in my sculptures. Many times, my artworks are related to one another because they were cast from the same mold. I begin with an original sculpture and make a silicone rubber mold of the sculpture, which captures its shape, details, and textures. These molds are the templates I use to make casted duplicates of the original sculpture. Because of the silicone rubber's physical flexibility, I'm able to cut up the mold, fold it, and distort it if I choose to create different kinds of variations in my casts. I find casting to be an expression of the intricacies of lineage, including where we come from, how we evolve, and how we still reflect and hold the qualities of those who came before us. I think of my work as being in relationship to each other from sharing the same mold and being made from the same materials, or even having my works function physically in the creation of other works. For example, I made plaster casted vases which were used as pouring vessels for paint for many of my paintings. These kinds of gestures are inspired by relationships found in nature, such as symbiotic relationships, life feeding on other life, or the self-providing that comes from the procreator to the creation. The visible marks in my work record my own actions and gestures, expressing my own presence as the maker. For example, I pour, splatter, or smear paint. Leaving the behavior of marks up to chance can both express an action inflicted by my own presence, but also can potentially convey a life force that is beyond my control. Adam Welch says, the act painting is of the same metaphysical substance as the artist's existence. In many cases, when I am making a work, I am never certain how the final product will look. When I make a mold of an object, I apply paint to the interior of the mold without knowing entirely how it will print onto the cast that gets produced. I build molds that I fill with found clay and then cut the sculpture in half to reveal its inside. I make paintings that are built up to be reversible and reveal the backside of the painting. The element of chance involved in my art making is connected to my ideas of the unpredictability involved in the creation of life, which is evident in birth, genetics, or evolution. Thank you. And up next, I would like to welcome Tino Gonzalez.
Hello. Thanks, Courtney. I appreciate that. And thanks to everyone for being here. It means a lot to have space to share all of our hard work and to have all these people in attendance. And so my art practice really grows out of where I'm from, New Mexico. And there, ufology, adobe earth building, and radio technologies are fixtures embedded in the landscape. And I find myself researching these interests as a way for me to investigate the overlaps between the terrestrial and the extraterrestrial, the collision of the supernatural and the scientific, and also as a means for me to connect with my regional and my familial history. And so that said, there's a lot of research that goes into my work. And so tonight, I'm actually going to read some more personal anecdotes and some quotes from my thesis. And so again, thanks for this time. And I'm going to start with a quote from Lucy Lepard. Without adobe, New Mexico would drift unmoored from its spiritual and cultural past. You have to make sure it's the right texture, my father emphasized as he reached into the pit of the adobe mixture. Grasping a heap of the mud and straw in his hand and staring at it intently, he said to me, once you form it into a ball and the shape holds, then you're ready to load it into the mold. The strata of the earth is a jumbled museum. Embedded in the sediment is a text that contains limits and boundaries which evade the rational order and social structures which confine art. In order to read the rocks, we must be conscious of geologic time and of layers of prehistoric material that is entombed in the earth's crust. Telecommunication networks overcome all natural obstacles like mountains, oceans, rivers, but also all historically determined social and cultural ones, and all dividing lines between private and public. As a young boy in Las Lunas, I would sleep at my Nana's house when she was sick with bone marrow cancer. In those years before her passing, we would stay up and talk, scratching each other's backs until we grew tired. Every night she would turn her radio to her preferred talk shows. She liked Buck and Dex or something like that. But as the night went on and she fell asleep, her radio would drift to Art Bell's late night talk show, Coast to Coast. I would stay up wide-eyed absorbing this strange station where UFOs and the paranormal were a constant topic. People would phone in and strangers in the night all across America would exchange tales of the unknown. The conversations and stories shared here would leave a lasting impression upon my young mind. Appearances of blinking ellipsoids, whirling orbs, and hovering illuminations have been reported and recorded since biblical times, and especially following the onset of atomic warfare and subsequent testing. Whether based in empirical reality, paranoia projection, false memories, or an innate desire to realize an archetype of wholeness, UFOs have captivated the popular and artistic imagination. Las Lunas, autumn, 9 years old, evening time. It must have been just after sunset. The gravel on the dirt road scraped and crunched like a persistent drumbeat beneath my sneakers as I walked home from the neighbor's house. At the onset of a cool breeze, the tempo stopped, and a small plume of dust arose from my feet as I came to a halt. My attention was drawn skyward. A silence enveloped my body in an invisible cocoon. A light, a single warm orange glow, began to slowly breathe in the sky. It must have been something like 80 feet above my body, though I couldn't gauge the actual height. I was awestruck. that this was just the beginning of the performance. The hovering orb pulsed off and only the burning after image hung in the sky. Another glow opposite the first blinked on and quickly turned off. Then a dazzling array of lights danced on and off in an inexplicable sequence. After reaching a frantic chorus, without warning and all at once, the lights disintegrated into the sky, leaving some kind of luminous scar floating in the atmosphere. The cumulative sum of these singing lights formed the shape of a saucer. Yet as soon as the entire shape made itself visible, the object seemed to disappear or be plucked from the sky by some mysterious force. I couldn't tell you how long the event lasted. Fear, excitement, wonder, confusion, and so many other feelings washed over me. I ran home. It is possible to both understand and reject, to love and detest, to be loyal and question, and above all, to continue to seek enlightenment out of the ambiguity and contradiction of all social existence. In Borderlands, Gloria Anzaldúa establishes the border between two countries as a metaphor for all types of crossings, between geopolitical boundaries, sexual transgressions, social dislocations, and the crossings necessary to exist in multiple linguistic and cultural contexts. Anzaldúa argues that living in the borderlands creates a third space between cultures and social systems. The word borderlands denotes that space in which antithetical elements mix, neither to obliterate each other nor to be subsumed by a larger whole, but rather to combine in unique and unexpected ways. That's all I have for tonight. Thank you so much. And up next we have Master Weaver and my good friend Margot Becker, who will be speaking.
Hi, thank you, Tina. Weaving is a language, a code, a map, an archive. It is ancient and mythological, practiced by artisans all over the world for at least 40,000 years. I want it to save us all, but it will not. I know my craft and I know its history. I can tell you about the ancestors of my materials. I can show you the tragic intertwinement of cloth and capital. I can trace the correlations between ecological, tentacular, and textile thinking. The comfort in finding and naming the relationships and patterns that shape the world around us is reminiscent of the relief in gaining control of fluff, of spinning wool into a clear individual strand that can be arranged into recognizable weave pattern and fashioned into a sheltering cloth. Sometimes I think I'm on the verge of solving a grand puzzle about relationships. It is possible to draft the fabric of our time and reweave it into a friendlier cloth. I've read dozens of myths in which the mastery of a thread holds the fate of the world. The uncanniness of the echoes between cloth and cosmos, between material and immaterial, has led me to the brink of magical thinking. But the terrific reality of the here and now is that while humans have a greater understanding of the complexities and limits of this world than ever before, we cannot gain control of our fate. As much as I wish I could, I cannot weave us out of climate change. I identify as a weaver and aim to be an expert in this craft while remaining open to all that weaving can be. Therefore, my work ranges from complex weave structures created on a jacquard loom to video, sound, and dance pieces. I weave present day iterations of the nature textile. By present day, I mean the 20-aughts, a global immigration crisis, Standing Rock, Flint water crisis, Black Lives Matter, Paris Climate Agreement, the Trump phenomenon, a glacier funeral, Jeff Bezos, Greta Thunberg, Bernie Sanders, AOC, the campfire, SpaceX, 3 billion birds gone, 2,266 mass shootings from December 2012 to October 2019, cotton sprouted on the moon, the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster, an all-female spacewalk, Brexit, the Amazon is still on fire. Australia has been on fire. COVID-19, the Anthropocene, Capitalocene, the Lulocene epoch. By nature, I mean a questionable term we use to group everything in the world, from a chirping robin born in New Hampshire last spring to a zircon crystal formed 4,400 million years ago in Australia, as one phenomenon from which humans and human-made things are excluded. And textile. A type of cloth or woven fabric. And what is a weaving? It is a noun and a verb. It is a grid of threads. It is the nexus of parts when they join to find new meaning. It is the coding of material into new material form. It is the conversion of many into one. It is ancient and universal. It is a record of an action and the physical manifestation of the weaver's time. It is a rudimentary skill and is the product of and basis for complicated computations. It is the record of a weaver's place, intention, and material life. I learned to weave on a floor loom, which is the bridge between handcraft and machine perfection. It is rhythmic but not consistent. In the act of weaving, cloth emerges as a chaos of threads is ordered into a pattern. Floor loom weaving is a system which an individual human must engage or disengage. It is also possibly irrelevant in the face of ongoing invention of new textile machines and technologies that can produce faster and with more precision. There is a futility in the act of cloth production on a floor loom in the modern technological age. And it is in such futility that I find potent meaning as a weaver in this modern age. I am drawn in with awe of the bewildering interconnectivity of the world around us. The intercommunications of trees, the role of the ant. Humanity's influence and observance has reached every corner of the planet. Scientists are able to witness, understand, and share their findings of this world like never before. Yet at the same time, planet Earth is experiencing its sixth mass extinction. And while it is known to be caused by the human, quote, us, it is soon to consume us. We feel powerless in stopping it. As quickly as we understand the intricacies and importance of the multitude of species with which we share this earth, we are losing them. The distinct and horrific tragedy of this moment is that the more we know about the planet, the more we see how much harm is being done. Harm in the form of atmospheric temperature change due to cars and planes. Harm in the form of habitat fragmentation with roads, tracks, and canals. Harm in the form of waste, plastic, mechanical, and textile waste. To weave a present day iteration of the nature textile is to contend with all of the complications and contradictions, to reincorporate human and nature while being aware of my history and place. I believe that the art that is atmospheric, emotional, and meditative gives the needed space for the feelings and frustrations. The effects of climate change are not universal, and therefore, there needs to be space for many different feelings. While climate change's global effects, it is experienced on the local and individual level. My climate grief may not come in the same flavor as yours, but we are both experiencing it. To weave a nature textile in 2019 is to weave together feelings that are at times in direct conflict, and to create work that is not prescriptive, political, or assumptive. Facing climate change seems so impossible. We cannot escape the planet, yet we do not seem to know how to live here. The panic that brings on solutionism is not helpful here. The only way to live through this climate catastrophe is to change the very fabric of our society, and this will require adapting to a new way of life. To do this, patterns of behavior must be changed, as well as the expectation of past repetitions. Instead of indulging in future fears and fantasies, I focus on the fell line of the weaving of our time. Thank you. Next up, we have Nargis Porsadecki.
Thank you, Margot. My name is Nargis Porsadecki, and my thesis is a fiction story read by my daughter, Armita. Thank you for listening.
Hole. And she continued, "This is a moment in time that had stopped and now has started moving again. I couldn't move, couldn't talk, just watched her fade away little by little and cried. Click. I just had a dream that I wish was just a dream. She swallowed her tears again. Her head is blank. She can't think anymore, but she can feel her wet hand. It's disgusting. It's warm. Summer of 2005. It's 2 a.m. in the morning. She couldn't remember what had happened exactly. She had to save herself from there somehow. She knew no one would defend her. No one would help. Think. She had to run. She didn't have enough energy to fight back. Her left hand and feet severely hurt. They were useless. She needed something to scare him. Think. There's a knife on the kitchen cabinet. Will it work? She gathered the rest of her energy and jumped. I was lying down in front of a window with a sunset view. A bias line of orangish color cut my fingers. Looking at my fingertips, the only point that was focused and concentrated. I loved my hand, and that is all. My hand was getting darker and darker as the sun set, yellow, gray, bruised. There was an even darker place in my body, a little black hole in my chest, sucking me inside. How do I look? I can't see my face. I was in pain. I didn't know it would hurt that much. Don't be harsh on me. I'm tired and I'm old. My lips are dry, too dry to speak. I once fell in love with someone. After a while, he wasn't there, and I faced absolute fear. I thought he was there waiting for me, but I couldn't find him. I always wondered if he loved me too. It was love at first sight. 4 a.m. in the morning, in front of my parents' house. The sun wasn't up yet. There was no sound, no birds in the sky, no cars, no people. Life had not started to wake up yet at 4 a.m. in the morning, but I could feel the gaze of crows between branches looking at us. He is in front of me, right in front of the house. I suddenly woke up, ran towards the door, opened it, and looked outside. He stood there, looking at me for a few minutes, smiled, and then turned to the right of the alley and left me. I couldn't say anything, couldn't move. The room is quite dark. All the windows are covered with thick maroon curtains. Smoke elegantly steps into the broken lights, sneaking in through the tears of the curtains, stealing the hearts of hypnotized eyes, and then disappears. There are curved bodies around the room and girls who gently serve them. The sound of pouring wine and the whisper of the girls who invite them to have more add more intimacy to the room. He wants to stay here forever. Add more poppy to his pipe. Poppy capsules are known for their ability to drown you into Lethe. What is it that you want to desperately forget? I lost someone, tears dripping from his face. The one person who liked me and trusted me. Well, we all have our sob stories. The world where all death is meaningless. I wish to see it myself. Click. Can you hear me? Pictures don't have sound. They are silent.
Thank you for listening to my shortest story. And I'm honored to introduce Katie Smarts.
Thank you, Nigel. Can you all hear me? Okay. I wonder, where does my queerness reside in me? Is it barricaded, incorporated? In my childhood memories, how does gravity work? Where are those memories sequestered, or is it more like they are knitted in? When I look at them, am I pulled, tilting forward, or am I trying to fall back? These questions, too, are the seeds of my work. I ask them with an awareness of othering that can take me out of the norm and place me in the community of others who live in alterity. The disorienting of queerness, as from the expected common path,
can contest not only heteronormative assumptions, but social conventions and orthodoxies in general. One must be disoriented to wonder what it means to be oriented. Sarah Ahmed. When I talk about showing new worlds, I am talking about the feeling of discovery of that transformative journey. Travel changes one. Whether the transport is mental or physical, one's conceptions and mindset can't help but be broadened. When one sees oneself clearly and understands the forces that have acted upon one's life and sense of self, there is the chance to build a better system out of that understanding. This is not to say that we can necessarily break all the bonds of interpolation once they become visible, but it is an argument for the worth of awareness and striving themselves on the path to become more free. The twin processes of the intuitive act of creation and the paradigmatic shift are imaginative, inventive, and all about discovery. I try to map my internal environment, focusing on personal truths that might translate to universal ideas and resonate with the viewer. I speak here of a universality that surpasses the paths we are situated along and travel through. The universality of the parent's love for the child or the grief we feel when someone beloved is in pain. I believe this mapping must be done not as a set of acceptable certainties whose straight lines and impermeable edges couldn't help but fail, but rather the unique understanding that can come from the partially glimpsed environments of thought suggested in abstraction, approached sideways, slantways, tilted, queered, off the beaten path or showing desire paths picked out rather than sidewalks poured and distinct, like a Zen koan or a teaching story, all the more personal for its open-endedness. I'm talking about how a blurry photo might be more compelling for what it suggests, or how the dreamlike, blurred and melding shapes in an abstract painting might evoke something intimate as a dream. Suggestions and associations can interact with our subjective realities more directly than something unambiguous might. As I explore and experiment, I ask myself, what if it were possible to illuminate our imagined and remembered environments and see them reveal themselves like invisible ink under a lamp? Perhaps we could understand the structures, groupings, expectations, proximities, and possibilities we long for or need to escape. What if this revelation could, like the recognition of emotional patterns, yield greater agency? It has been helpful to consider what happens when the container of the body doesn't match what's inside, be it gender orientation or other expectations from within or without. This idea lends itself most easily to trans people, but the idea is also able to be extrapolated to a variety of human experiences. In my work, I evoke body-like forms with different outlines, some showing uncertainty, some interacting with other forms, some with layers of boundaries, and others with only one. If the body is the container, then my color fields are inspired by that which is contained. I imagine depicting the soul or simply the experiences of life coalescing to form a self. Sometimes the color field stays within its boundaries, sometimes it explodes out. Other times it may have a distinct shape all its own that overlays boundaries without losing distinctness. For me, this echoes the myriad ways in which people interact with their own physical forms. I imagine a form existing above and below the horizon whose contents overtake its boundaries. I long to suggest with this form something useful, some comfort or new perspective to a viewer who also feels, like many of us do, like we hide within our boundaries or overflow untidily out. When I came out as bisexual, I found myself between worlds. Having expected to enter a welcoming LGBTQ plus culture, I instead found the plural nature of my desires a handicap. I was between the worlds of straight and gay, unwelcome and misunderstood on each side. There did not exist a line for me to follow and be accepted. Following lines decides proximity of some things and not others. Direction and the things we face are acted on by external forces, shapes, and distances. What you don't know, you can't choose. Sarah Ahmed. I was proximate to the straight and non-straight worlds, but could be fully enveloped in neither. In one of my paintings, a trans person might leap off a cliff, seeking and fearing and unmaking, after Jack Halberstam, in order to be remade. I'd show the new shapes they might discover, the new realities that might be called into being. In a world I've created, an act of radical bravery like that might well bend the laws of gravity, warping the environment to something brand new. A bisexual person like myself might traverse the distances between straight, gay, and heteronormative spaces, triangulating a desire path between the pulling pressures, looking with hope to a horizon that suggests diversity in color, shape, and conception. My hope for this work is for it to be destabilizing and lyrical, functioning as transport for catharsis, recognition, escape, or modern sublimity. The paintings follow internal logic specific to their worlds, while being abstract enough to be accessible to broad interpretation. I visualize these portals as other worlds and fertile places that keep open the potential of innovative thinking, a comforting place that speaks on behalf of what needs to be acknowledged or validated. I want to show why it is such an effort to be true to your own strange self and why it can be worth it. I long to share internality, possibility, and that which is buried, that it might be gainfully, perhaps even gleefully, unearthed. Thank you. And now I'd like to welcome Jordan Hartney.
Thank you, Katie. My thesis is The Sacred Cyborg. My subjective view is cyborgian, though not cyborg in the traditional sense. There are no cybernetic parts inside my human body or prosthetic limbs attached. My situation is less surgical and more evolutionary, less cutting, sawing, and attaching, and more subliminal, organic, and parasitic. I was born in 1993 as a cyborg, created by an electrician and a factory worker in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Porous to the world, available to be socially confined at the hands of my family, environment, and culture, primed to be molded a human. I was born into a world already merged with technology, merged with electricity, cars, computers, machines, factories, etc. As I grew up in this world, I fell into the desire to play games on a screen rather than in the vastness of my backyard or the nature that surrounded me. Not only do I consider myself a cyborg, I am also a genderless consciousness in a female body. I define consciousness as the immaterial part of being human, the spirit, psyche, inner self, inner being, life force, subconscious of an individual. It is the most human thing, but not seen. It's within all of us and supposedly connected to the universe, the cosmos, all creation. I question this odd awareness. What is this genderless consciousness driving around in this female vessel? Even though I do not share the same deep, intrinsic female perspective as the generation before me, I have this body. This is what I'm in, this is what I am, but when I meditate, I identify more as cyborg than anything else. I first detach from my external connections, my second brain, placing my exoskeleton in another room, clicking everything to do not disturb mode, logging off from the world, detaching from my environment, shutting down my brain, feeling my thoughts lose electricity. My body is technology itself. I'm unplugged from existence, and I is just contained by this female meat machine. Through meditation, I distill the world, the weeks and days of being in this body, the interactions I've had with individuals, society, culture, and community, distilling the ecological spheres that perceive and shape me. Identifying as cyborg influences the way I view identity. The sum total of my experiences, the society that I live in, the way I was raised, the media that saturates me, and the technology that's intertwined with my mind and body. What does it mean to have an identity in the 21st century? If I'm in coexistent cycles with my environment, tools, creations, how is my identity gender evolving? How do I, a subject of the 21st century, pull out my individual agency to have freedom? Through installation, sculpture, and painting, my bodies of work are intended to create an awareness of our cyborg conditions, to engage our senses in order to encourage a questioning of autonomy in regards to human will, and to question our coexistence. In the sculptural painting, Echo X, an inner landscape of a genderless cyborg is revealed. There is a variation of fusing. The bodily configuration lays down ideas of Frankenstein's creature, spiritual centers of the body, and the hybrid nature. Sacred geometry transitions to digital lines, which then shift through the skeletal body. Looking closer, elemental body structures come alive when the paint resembles a passing cloud or water patterns in the foreground. This image includes elements breaking down and building, evoking ideas of archetypes, evolution, and transformation. The painting is in stasis, confined by a mirror finished steel frame with layering of fragmented plexiglass over the surface. The plexi triggers an imagination of transparency and unknown forces, while the etched layers depict a programmed matrix. In the installation Czar Biome, I investigate a proliferating dreamscape of a mind-body ecosystem. What happens when material realities and dream realities start to fuse? There is an element of biomimicry, imitation of models, systems, and elements of nature that become apparent through the crystal structures, binding of networks, blending of natural and synthetic fibers, extending patterns, and spun formations. With certain pastel colors, prismatic holographic shards, and a flow of manifested structures, a dreamy haze is stimulated for the viewer. The threaded fibers that wrap around the steel surfaces and through the space relate to the way thoughts and dreams are interconnected, how veins circulate the body, and how muscle and skin wrap around bone. Roaming around the space, these figures depend on one another, all subsumed in an invading web, fusing cyborgian intimacy. Thank you for listening. I now introduce Maxine Schoferwolf.
Thank you all for being here, and thank you, Jordan. I'm Maxine Schoferwolf, and I'll be reading from my thesis titled Between the Moon and a Flower. Ongoingness. In Anna Maria Maiolino's Porum Fio, by a thread, 1976, a black and white photograph captures a simple gesture, a thread passed from one mouth to another. The gesture is shared between three people. The artist herself sits in the middle, a girl, her daughter, to her left, and an older woman, her mother, to her right. The transmission does not extend beyond these three women. It stops in the artist's mother's mouth, the grandmother's, and in the mouth of the granddaughter. Do the threads end in the mouths or disappear into the bodies of the women, down throats to where food is digested or sounds are made? Maybe they emerge from this place. Though the three women seem at ease and their gazes calm, their mouths are holding. The thread's position is precarious, dependent on each person in the lineage. Is the thread a stand-in for language? The thin line of communicability embedded in the thickness of life? If one of the figures were to open her mouth to make an utterance, to speak a word, the thread would fall out. The thread represents a tension between saying and not saying, between speaking with words out loud or silently through the body. The thread could be a stand-in for the limited and fragile system of language or for haptic embodied transmission. What has been carried and passed along quietly, even secretly, silently, through bodies and time. Between the mouths, the thread is not taut. Instead, it hangs in catenary curves, loosely suspended in the air, sagging from its own weight. The thread enacts a lag, a weight, and a spaciousness. What happens within gaps between bodies? Blue flowers, vergiss mein nicht. When my German great-grandmother left her daughter in the Austrian Alps as World War II broke out, my grandmother ate blue flowers, forget-me-nots. These days, she likes flowers in her kitchen and keeps telling me how she can't remember. between the moon and the flower. And this excerpt begins with a quote from Haldur Laxness's book, Under the Glacier. I have the glacier, and of course the lilies of the field. They are with me, I am with them, but above all, the glacier. I've been thinking about my place between the moon and a flower. On the one hand, I am bigger than the flower, a body that I can pluck from the ground that blooms within a season, sometimes within days. But how is my single lifespan enmeshed with recurring perennials that have adapted to survive from one year to the next, flowering over many seasons? My mortality rubs against the unfolding of a single plant's blossom and against the cycles of millions of plant species that have existed long before humans evolved. And the moon, perceivable for most of us only from a vast distance as a steady cyclical presence and absence in the night sky, but whose surface is marked by unmoving boot prints and the remains of crushed spacecrafts. I am entangled with flower generations that will outlast me and with the threatened ongoingness of flower species in mass extinction. Counting moons, or something small can be something big, dwarfing the tower. Using film leader coated in black opaque emulsion, I count 16 millimeter film frames as they pass through my hands, punching a hole into every 29th frame to mark the full moon's recurring presence each month. When the hole punched film is projected at 24 frames per second, the traces of my gestures become accelerated. Within the black frame, a light-filled circle appears and disappears again and again. Working closely with artist Jim Campbell, I made an iteration of this project for the top of the Salesforce Tower, the tallest building in San Francisco, the city where I was born. The tower was completed in 2018, built on ground subject to potential liquefaction. It dominates the San Francisco skyline in its monumentality, as if it has been here all along. In my site-specific video, my hole-punched moon circled around the tower's four sides. I wanted to dwarf the building by materializing a scale of time that will outlast San Francisco. Simultaneously, my handmade and intimate gestures became gigantic, outsized. On the first night the video was screened, my hole-punched circles on the top of the tower shared a sky with a full moon and mirrored its scale. When the white circle disappeared briefly, only to reappear on another side of the tower, the full moon remained in the sky. Eating the blue flower. And this section begins with another quote from Haldur Laxness's book, Under the Glacier, and it's a dialogue between two characters. Oh no, better to be silent. That is what the glacier does. That is what the lilies of the field do. Are you sure the flowers are silent if a sensitive enough microphone were placed beside them? In shifting and unstable environmental and temporal relations, where vast, unfathomable bodies like the glacier or the weather are mutating due to human impact, I am wary of grand gestures. I find myself looking to small and tangible fragments. I am comforted by cycles. I make one hole punch, then another. And I am still thinking about my grandmother eating blue flowers. This memory, this story of a brief moment, is also a fragment within an unknowable whole. The small flower holds the possibility of memory traveling through the hand of a child into her organs and through her mouth to my mother's and to mine. So there's the question of ongoingness. To be passed along, the flower had to be destroyed, ingested, and carried through bodies. Ongoingness is not permanence or preservation, but inevitable loss, mutation, and precarity. In The Mushroom at the End of the World, Anand Singh suggests that precarity is the condition of our time, not an exception to how the world works. Precarity means vulnerability in relation to others, vulnerability to transformations that can unmake and remake us. In my studio, I've become obsessed with the story of forget-me-nots, fixated on the gaps and questions it opens. Did my grandmother, the girl, consider the flower's aliveness before she ate it? And the color blue? Was she eating words, forget me not? And who is forgetting whom? Who is imploring to be remembered? I consider the aliveness of flowers now in writing of them and in my studio. If thread is passed from grandmother to granddaughter, do I hold the blue flower, its memory, in the place where food is digested and sounds are made? Maybe my work comes from this place. In their mutating ongoingness, the small blue flowers hold the incongruities and entanglements from which my work emerges. Thank you, everyone. And I now have the pleasure of introducing Frances Richard for her concluding remarks.
I guess I was waiting for my little face to pop up, but I guess I should just talk. Thank you all. It was incredible to hear those beautiful texts in such fullness. And it's reminding me what I've often thought of how thesis writing is a wild and woolly, wide-ranging, deep delving process. I think it's not an overstatement to say that people's thinking and working habits as artists are transformed by going through this process. In my experience as a teacher, it's also a marvelously collaborative and mutually supportive thing to do. And I think you could hear in these texts the sympathies and overlaps and interlacings amongst the subject matters as well as the stylistics of what people have produced. The thesis writing cohort becomes a functioning writing group, reading each other's drafts, commenting on each other's prose craft, suggesting references, sharing speculations, busting through blocks, and watching with informed fascination as discoveries from the writing process feed into and loop back from work in the studio. From primordial beginnings to UFOs and cyborgs to tentacular thinking and the sixth extinction, fictions of the self as other and the communities of alterity, moving along desire paths to the space between the moon and a flower, we get to travel with these artists, and I'm so glad that we've had a chance to be together in our distance to hear these amazing texts. We have time for a few questions. If you participants, you 60 participants out there in space would like to enter them into the Q&A chat box, I can relay them. Especially if you might have questions that could be addressed to the group, although we're not limiting exclusively to those. And I have a question that I can seed the cloud with a little bit. Maybe you all could talk briefly about the most important takeaway or discovery, whether in regard to your own research and the process of writing or having to do with that feedback loop amongst and between writers and between writing and studio practice that you all have talked about and that I was just mentioning. Maxine, do you want to?
Sorry, I didn't mean to disappear as soon as you asked me to talk. Bye. The feedback loop between what were the writing process and the making process.
Yeah.
I think for me specifically, that one anecdote of the blue flowers is something that I started thinking about in the beginning of my time at CCA And it wasn't until I was writing the thesis that I realized that it was really feeding into all of my work in a strange way, even when it wasn't sort of more directly depicting perhaps that incident or engaging with it in a very direct way. It became really about this question of relationship of scale and interconnected timelines. And so writing the thesis was a helpful way for me to then connect the dots between my different projects through that story specifically.
Yeah, does somebody else want to take that up?
I think for me, the most important thing was sort of exercising the muscle and learning how to use the experience and action of running towards whatever it is you're the most scared of. And I think in terms of like realizing that you can't be self-protective and make good work, that you really do have to get into the weeds of whatever's most vulnerable to you. And so learning that was the most valuable lesson for me.
Anyone else want to speak to that?
For me personally, writing was always a challenge, but whenever you start to dive into your thoughts and like psychological processes and how you start to create and how you form your ideas and how like these things manifest, it really just brought to light what you create. It just brings to light and it sheds water on those seeds for artists. I mean, for me especially, it was just insane to like really understand what was going on in my own practice. And I just want to say, I haven't heard everybody's like excerpts and I am just blown away. Like, wow, you guys.
Yeah, I agree. It was really exciting to just hear everyone's writing in this way and just to see everyone speak it. I feel like, wow, these are all like performances in their own way. But the most valuable thing was like, also just being in the classroom and talking with one another about these ideas. I think that's when the real value comes out and you start to unlock like why it is we're interested in these things and you know what we have to say. And so I'm really thankful that we all got to share classes together, either with you, Francis, or Karen. And Sam was asking a question about us revisiting these, you know, and it's exciting, you know? And then it also just like makes me realize how much more I want to write and explore some of these things and how excited I am to see like what everybody else continues to do. So endlessly thankful for that, for sure.
Yeah, Sam Soon has asked a question that's building on the question I asked. So I'll just read it out loud and insert it. How do you all feel revisiting the thesis writing you did months ago now that we're at the very end of the program? Also, how did you select the excerpts you ultimately chose to read and share? And they add great work to each of you, and congrats. Jillian, you want to take that up, including that issue about revisitation of completed work and how you selected excerpts?
Sure. I guess for me personally, the excerpts I selected were about my sculptural piece that kind of lives disjointedly on the online platform. And so I wanted the opportunity to kind of flesh it out in a different way. And I think also it's been a process of collaborating with my cohort, and Maxine and I have back and forth been like, should I do this? Helping each other edit and brainstorm what we're thinking about. Even in the early process of writing our thesis, we all kind of brainstormed, and Francis kept getting us to like say what the thesis of our thesis was. And I know mine was like, I am thinking about, and you know, and going from that spot to like the written full thesis is very like thinking about how huge of a leap that was is amazing. And then also like hearing everybody read their excerpts tonight was another level of like understanding that now I'm like, I want everybody to read me their entire thesis now. So yeah, and I wish that like we weren't in the process of the MFA program. I wish that we had that time to like really spend with each other to be like, what are you thinking about and what am I thinking about? I feel like just tonight I'm like, oh my God, there are so many overlaps that I wish that I had explored further, not meaning that we can't Zoom later. But yeah.
Courtney, do you want to jump in there?
Yeah, I found that when I was writing my thesis or when I was beginning to, it felt like everything I was really passionate about were in different categories. And the more that I wrote my thesis and got to the heart of the subject of it, I was like, oh, these things actually are all within the same world. And there's a reason I'm attracted to all of these things. So that was something really enlightening about the thesis, and also just from conversations with classmates and working on artist statements and so forth. It was really interesting to pick up the thesis for tonight and realize I was rereading it and trying to decide which parts I wanted to include, and realizing, I was like, oh gosh, I didn't even talk about this, or like, now that time has passed, like, I'm thinking so much more about these things. And so it is, I think having to like get it published and like finalized and turned in was a good thing. But on the other hand, it's definitely going to be a forever evolving thing that I come back to.
Margot?
Yeah, I think sort of jumping off from that, it was hard in the writing process. I wanted so badly to include absolutely everything that I had ever thought about in weaving. And I sort of felt like, oh, if I left anything out, that would be it. And now I realize that I'm happy that I cast such a large net, because when I went back through to look at what excerpts I would include, I feel like I just laid this like nice mossy groundwork and can dig into the different pieces now. And it's such a good jumping off platform to have as we graduate and figure out what our next bodies of work are going to look like.
Nargis, do you want to speak to that question of revisiting the work once it was completed and what it was like to present in the form that you used with Mita?
Revisiting was hard. Seeing, like, reading again the stories that I see a lot of lack of writing into it, I think, and I like organizing my chaos mind is so hard in general, and like making the combination of the story in one story, and always like rearrange my pictures that I have in my story. So it's like when I revisit it, I literally want to rearrange it again and play with it again and change it. So it's like, it was fun and it was sometimes in some part disappointing.
Like all writing.
Exactly.
Karen, do you want to wrap us up? Do you have a question you want to ask or comment to follow with?
I could ask a question or we could wrap up. I just saw that you did.
A question popping up.
I think maybe I'll combine my question with Judith's. Is mm-hmm. that okay?
Perfect.
Judith is asking, I'd be interested in the most significant shifts in your practices that the thesis research generated. Oops, it just disappeared.
Oops.
I think there is a congratulations after that, but I think that's the whole question. And I was interested to hear if you, what, looking back on the process, what your advice would be to the next cohort in terms of what you learned in terms of actually engaging with the thesis process. But also I'm just really interested, after having taught thesis now for several years, the way that students and you all have combined the research, what, you know, you think is more as critical or academic, with fiction and fictional autobiography. And it's just interesting, the blending of those voices that really create such a unique work in the end. Or with Nargis, I mean, it almost ends up being like a graphic novel. I mean, the fact that you felt you could combine your images and your stories in a different way. So I lost Judith's question now, but maybe we should mostly address that.
I'll just read Judith's question again. It's here in the Q&A chat. She asks, I'd be interested in the most significant shifts in your practices that the research generated. And she adds, so amazing, congratulations.
And with that shift, maybe you'd offer some advice, or what you would feel is the one thing you learned about that process too.
Yeah, Courtney.
I would say that spewing was actually really helpful for me in getting the thesis began in the first place, just to like non-judgmental getting words out and kind of just following the threads of what my thinking was. And I think how it informed my work was that while I was making things, I was really recognizing the words that stuck out to me, or the visuals that were sticking out to me as I was writing. And then when I'd go back to making, I was kind of able to recognize those things when they were happening and be like, oh, this is important to my thesis. And like, I should lean into this part more than the other things. So it kind of gave me visually more things to explore in regards to like what I was already gravitating towards in my writing.
Katie, yeah.
I think the biggest shift for me was realizing that the landscapes were not literal landscapes, but that they were ciphers or conceptual spaces that were performing a function, and what that function was and why. I think once I plugged into that and was able to let go of, it's just an important landscape and I can't articulate why, then I really had a direction to go. And I guess for advice, I guess I would just reiterate, don't waste time trying to protect yourself. Just run straight into whatever is scariest.
Anyone else want to speak to that? Yeah, Maxine.
In terms of how it's influenced my practice, this the writing process, I think it really shaped my the piece that I made for the thesis website, in the sense that that piece began combining sort of these small fragments and repetitive gestures, or linking those and sort of vast bodies like the ocean that was sort of playing in the last part of my reading. Though I was linking those to the period of time that my mother was pregnant with me in terms of a timeline. And so it was a way for me to link sort of embodied lineages with faster time scales. And I think writing the thesis allowed me to really realize that that's what my work was wanting to do. And then in terms of advice, I think starting very early with your research, even before the class begins, because coming back, this kind of answers the earlier question, coming back to this for this process, I realized I could cut so much and it still worked. Like, these are excerpts of various sections that I had, and sort of puzzling it together, I could cut so much and it still worked. And so I think if I just had, you know, now I would just say start early so you can go back and edit when you're not as attached to particular sentences or words, or, you know, so it was very helpful for me to go back and have that distance perspective.
Yeah, I mean, I feel similar, like not just in the act of writing the thesis, but in just being in graduate school and, you know, all these different interests and ideas that we have. For me, it was like figuring out a way to move away from not just representing these ideas, but actually like embodying them and living them out. And within the writing, you realize, at least for me, how much of what I'm talking about has been kind of humming within me my whole life. And it's just, you know, giving yourself the time to really unpack what it is that you're thinking about. And I'm reminded of being in your class, Francis, where you're like, well, what are you trying to say? And then I say it and you're like, well, then just say that, just say the thing, you know, and like you just said it. And so I find myself when I'm giving advice to others or to myself is like, whatever comes out is valuable and has something. And so with that, like the advice is, you know, just write down as much as you can, whether you're walking or riding the train, if that ever happens again, you know, just write down whatever thought you have, if it's poetic or unrelated or just an idea, just jot down and go back to your notebooks and reread them, because there's a lot of gems that come out in talking with one another and giving yourself time to just deeply think about why we're doing what we're doing.
Yeah, Marco.
Yeah, definitely. I think also don't underestimate the bravery that it takes to make statements about your work. It's so personal. And so realize that that's what you're heading into, is this space of deep vulnerability. And also realize that you're in a room of people who are going through this as well and being brave with you. And so leaning on your cohort and learning about how they're thinking about your work and talking to them about their work will help you so much. I think that I'm gonna be like spending the next year unpacking how my practice has shifted and how myself has shifted in this program, at least. immediately, I think just not like, and still working towards being comfortable, not having the answers, not assuming that my systems of thinking will always pan out, and being comfortable with looking at other ways of viewing the world. And I think that's also where your cohort comes in and will help you so much.
Yeah.
I just wanted to add to that. Drinking and writing is a really good way to get all of the stuff up that you're trying to get to. I know professors may not like go for that right now, but honestly, it's like you got to be honest with yourself and let it go. And like you find certain things within yourself and within your practice that you don't actually realize or connect. And like there's all these different webs that come into it. And it's a continuous practice. Like it's continuous. Like our thesis isn't finished. Like it's still going, it's still evolving, proliferating, and our works are doing the same. So my advice is to have a little notebook by the edge of your bed, because whenever you're going to sleep, you're going to wake up and be like, holy shit, I didn't even know. Like that's what connected to the writing, to the work, to this, like, and there's going to be little gems hidden in like little areas. So, and Francis really helped with that, to like really just rewire the mind, decalcify your thoughts, and like get to the source. So, yes.
Jillian, do you want to talk about the gem treasure hunt? and or any of these other topics?
Gem treasure hunt. I write a lot of notes to myself in the middle of the night on my phone. And then if my arms aren't working, I dictate it. But yeah, that's an option. I think when I started writing my thesis, I didn't think that anything was connected. I thought I had very disparate practices, like maybe like three or four different practices and bodies of work, but I realize they're all deeply connected. And I think that I would suggest to future cohorts or future students that just like write and write and write and write about your work, even if you don't want to write about your work, because it helped me so much to be able to talk about my work. Like, I can see such a change from last year to this year and how I speak about my work now and how I write about my work now. And then after the process of writing the thesis, I have all these words to pull from and this thinking to build on. And that's been really invaluable. And also to like seek out your cohort and exchange ideas and talk about what do you think, you know, from editing each other's work to talking about what they're interested in, even if it's complicated.
Nargis, do you want to add anything to that discussion, especially Karen's question about advice to rising second years?
My method was a little different. I was starting with the word, just like, but I was very careful for finding a word, what kind of word that I'm gonna use. And like, maybe I just start one story with just one word or one sentence and gather all of my imagination around that sentence and like word. And then I was always recording myself at night when I have some thing to write, because it was dark, always recording. It was better option for me. and I was rearranged my story a lot. It was a small part. All of them were a small part. And I don't know, like for other essays that people work on it, it was, for them also, it was very apart section or not. But mine was very apart and I had to connect them somehow. And I was thinking about what kind of elements that I can use to connect these section together. So I think the advice is like, start so soon, because you always need more time, and don't rush yourself to on the end of the semester to like, so if you start from the summer, just have a lot your research through the summer and like start your essay from the semester. It would be very helpful.
I just, one more thing I wanted to add that I forgot to say is to begin gathering artists that you admire or whose work you love very early. For the LA trip that each first year cohort does, we went to see the Ana Maria Maiolino exhibit, and I bought that postcard and of the image with a string, and it was hanging in my studio my whole time at CCA. And it wasn't until I began writing the thesis that I realized that it had been sort of in the back of my mind the whole time. So I just recommend really paying attention to the things that you're moved by, even if they're not immediately related to the medium of your practice, and to begin figuring out why and how they're influencing your work. It's fun to write about other people's work.
That's such good advice. And it's 7:30, so it seems like maybe that's enough. Jillian, something to add?
Yeah, we just want to thank Karen and Frances for all your encouragement and support during the thesis writing process, and for reading our thesis and words with such care. And we also wanted to thank Glenn and Kim for generously supporting us in our last semester and producing the website.
It's so wonderful to hear all of you. I can't tell you what a delight to hear all that. And I want to be in that reading, the extended story hour of multiple theses read start to finish while reclining on pillows in embodied presence with you all in the future.
Wow, next year marathon, bring your sleeping bag. Awesome. Popcorn. And to that, it's one of the things I love doing most at CCA is working on thesis projects with students. Even though sometimes I know it's scary and painful, it's always joyous when all these things come together. And last, I really want to thank Emily Shulman for just making everything work so smoothly and putting together the screen sharing PowerPoint, which I loved. I mean, obviously all this online stuff is not what any of us ever wanted or imagined, but the added benefit is I really just loved seeing the images while you were reading. So that's something we haven't had before at the regular thesis reading. So thank you, Emily, and everyone.
And I'm seconding the thank yous to Glenn and Kim and to all of you who've been listening. All you out there in TV land who are starting your theses, heed the wisdom of the group here. There's a lot of really powerful writing advice circulating around here right now. And for all of you, it's so exciting to see the writing group that you have, the artist group that you have, to continue as resources for each other into the future. Maybe it's a weird benefit of Zoom world that doesn't matter where you go, you can all still hang out with each other, and you know how to do that now. So thank you all for being with us. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you so much, everyone. It means so much.
Thank you, everyone. Yes. Good job, everybody. Thank you. Love you guys.
Love you.
Bye.